It's the height of everybody's conversation in football. How what's your views on VAR? And can we just go through your 5 points of what you feel would improve the system and help VAR to have just be better in our game?
Yeah. VAR is here to stay. 100%, it's here to stay. It's now been introduced in football. Everybody wanted it. Everybody. There was too many mistakes in high-profile situations not to have it. What you can't have is a massive match or a relegation and a team goes down on a bad offside call or a simulation of a penalty.
We've had 100 years.
Yeah, but people were complaining. People were complaining for years, so they wanted technology. Referees wanted support.
Yeah.
They did want support. Is VAR working? No. Is VAR got some good points? 100%. Because it's reducing red cards. There's been a reduction of 6 red cards at this for this match round from previous year. So therefore, you don't see off the ball incidents. It's very rare now, because players know that they're going to be retrospectively sent off at that match, not three games later. They're also, you're getting less holding in the penalty area, at attacking free kicks and corners, which is creating more chances. So it has got its positives, but there's many negatives.
Yeah.
You know, one of the negatives is offsides. Another negative is penalty kicks. For example, players' encroachment. We're now ultra-managing. We're using this technology and using it precisely. And I'm not comfortable with that. If a player comes inside by 1 millimetre or 2 millimetres and both players are in,
then you want the support. Yeah.
You said
the referees wanted the support. They're getting the support with their replays.
It's how it's used and why. When do we use it? You know, I was told when VAR was going to be introduced, it was going to be for clear and obvious mistakes.
Yeah.
We're not using... Are you telling me when a player comes in by 1 foot, that's a clear and obvious mistake? Because referees have allowed it for you. Why do referees stand 1 metre inside the penalty area? Why? Because if a player runs past your vision, you see it.
Yeah.
Because you're watching the penalty taker. Yeah. In case he does the step.
Yeah.
So you, as a player runs across you, you think, oh, that's not correct.
So you don't want that.
So
you don't want support there.
So you need tolerance. Football is about emotion, about, you know, the excitement. And what VAR is doing is killing this type of enjoyment. If we look at offsides, for example, we're now...
Yeah, let's go through your five points.
I talked about removing offsides.
Okay.
Because at the moment, we can't change the law. Because the law can't be changed till June the 1st.
Yeah.
If IFA make a decision in next month when they meet. So you've got two things. You either accept the technology, which is what all knows flawed, because when a player kicks the ball... And when they're actually looking at the 3D technology, it's not accurate enough. If we're talking about an armpit and a toenail, which is unique to the Premier League, because it doesn't happen all over the world, because the Premier League is the fastest and most exciting league in the world. Therefore, if we're going to talk about armpits and toenails, we'll have to take it out. We'll have to take it away from VAR till we get better technology or we change the law. And if we change the law, because we can't get better technology, then why not just take the line of the feet?
Yeah,
because what's happened now in football, and it's in the past, the advantage was always with the attacker, always in offside and in handball. Now VAR has taken both accounts back to the defender, so now a defender can handball in the penalty area, and an attacker does the same offence. Yeah. It's penalised by a disallowed goal, but you don't give a penalty. So therefore, the advantage. And offside now, there's no benefit. It's so black and white that an armpit can be offside. Have you ever heard of a player score with an armpit? Never. So I'm not comfortable with the way the offside at the moment, and it's spoiling the excitement. When a player used to look across at the assistant, and the assistant kept his flag down, a player used to go and celebrate. And the excitement and the rock.
But VAR is getting some of those decisions right, though, as well. Some tight ones we've seen, and then you do see VAR and you go, oh, he's offside. It has got those ones right, and it's cleared up those. It's more, to me, the technology doesn't seem right.
But what you've also got to understand, Robbie, is the assistants are encouraged not to flag. So we don't know at this moment in time how many of the offsides they would have made.
Yeah.
because with the technology, they're encouraged to keep it down, allow the conclusion of that incident.
Yeah, and then we go back and check.
When I was in the Premier League, the accuracy of assistant referees was unbelievable. That wasn't an issue with VAR. I never heard VAR was going to be introduced for offside. It wasn't really a major problem. But
wasn't it? There were often mistakes with offside. The goals were given with it.
There was, Robbie, but I'm talking minimal. Yeah. I'm talking minimal.
Wow.
It now, for me, where VAR is, it was brilliant to help the referees is more on the penalty kicks, because top level now in the Premier League, it was so difficult to judge. And players were becoming actors. They weren't just footballers, they were actors. And sometimes they were going down and you couldn't be 100%. And the worst feeling in the world is a referee, you give a penalty and you watch it back and there was no contact. So therefore, why can technology be able to reverse that? I was at my very first game at Old Trafford when I didn't give the ball over the line with Mendes.
Oh yeah, Mendes along, yeah.
I'm still on the videos now, the bloomers. But that could have been solved in seconds. That's what technology's for. The Thierry Henry handball, the Maradona handball. These are the scandals.
If he's armpit.
And they most often happen in the penalty box.
Yeah. Yeah.
Listen, we obviously offside's a thing. We want to try and get through your 5-point plan. Yeah. So that offside, you want that removed at the moment. Clear and obvious, the phrase. You're a little bit uncomfortable with that. It's a bit too grey. That it's not definitive enough.
Well, they set the bar at the start of the season. The Premier League came out and made a statement that the bar has got to be high.
Yeah.
What is high? What is clear and obvious? What is clear and obvious to you is different to me. Yeah. Therefore, nobody's got a clear guideline. And that's leading to inconsistencies. One week I'm seeing that they're coming out with a statement that the VAR has informed the referee that he's made a clear and obvious mistake, therefore we're given a penalty. Okay, I can accept that. Yeah. But then the next week it's not a penalty. So where is the clear and obvious? And because the VARs are different every week, and for every different game, the VAR might have a different guideline in his head, what's clear and obvious. And also they're using some inexperienced referees. Does he want to undermine the big experience guy?
Which is another point we'll get to. Because absolutely right. Our next one I'll read out for you. Allow the captains two challenges per match. So just
no. I think we'll cancel that. We'll cancel that.
No.
It's a mooted idea.
Yeah, just explain.
Why I put it in was that because at the moment it's not working. The clear and obvious, it's at a point where it's too inconsistent. People are still arguing about it. This team didn't get the red card, this team did, and everything else. And I just thought it works in other sports, like cricket, where the captain's allowed to have a challenge in discussion with his teammates. Yeah. They've got a set time. And if he loses them rights, if it was two a game and he lost them rights, then the ownership goes back onto them. People said to me, well, actually, they would use it for a tactic. They wouldn't because if they lost the two challenges when they felt wrong, what it would do is it would put the ownership from the referee. He would make his decision. The assistant would make his decision, like an offside. So we're not looking at armpits. And if a team thinks they've been wronged, then they say, I think I've been wrong. Can you have a look at it? And why not? Because it's just to have a look to see if it improves, because at the moment it needs to be improved. And I'm looking at probably some areas that could be trialed, maybe in a youth tournament, to see if it's got any benefit. If it hasn't got any benefit, then we'll leave it. But I think a player and a coach knows when they've been massively wronged. I'm not talking about wronged, like Mourinho yesterday about the throw-in.
Yeah.
That was so difficult.
Yeah.
You can't tell.
David Moyes one's interesting, isn't it, with Declan Rice in the head and the Snodgrass scores. That didn't feel right.
Well, it doesn't, that's the laws of the that's not VAR, that's the laws of the, laws of the new laws of the game. Yeah. So that's why I put the two challenges in.
Okay. Number four.
I think everybody in the world of football, the Premier League's been unique in this, because when it's been used in Italy, Spain, Australia,
this is
China.
Sort of that, just referees going to the monitors. Yeah, what you want. Yeah.
If we look at, for example, Aubameyang's red card yesterday, it happened in front of the technical area. So therefore, the monitor's in the technical area. The challenge happened two metres away. I'm not sure what the fourth official was doing. He may be having a cup of tea as the monitor. And what they've looked at is, people say to me, it's not a bad challenge. It isn't. There's no. It's not a challenge where he's meant to do it. Mm. But that's been taken out of the laws. What the referee has to do is deem the contact point. And the contact point, anything above the ankle, you're running the risk. Mm. Then you have to take the second point. Is there any speed? Is there any malice? Mm. And when you put these factors together, that's what you start building the red card. Yeah. So going back to the Robertson's tackle, that had more speed than a Aubameyang's.
Mm. Yeah.
So that's why I believe if one's going to be a red card, I think both should be a red card.
Mm. And the last point is getting the referees to wear live microphones and make the audio available to all inside the stadium and people watching at home. So yeah. Just explain that one too.
But at the moment, you know, people are less likely or wanting to go to the stadiums, you know, because the best experience you get now as a football fan is watching on TV.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you get replays, you're now getting the chance to see before anybody else the replays for VAR.
Yeah.
So to get people back into stadiums and to enjoy the experience of being in a stadium, they need to have identical situations. So, for example, if the referee goes to the pitch-side monitor, which should, he can then show the video to everyone. The TV companies get it. The big screen gets it. And open the audio between the guy in VAR, who's in an office in Stockley Park, so he's in a clean environment, and the referee. The argument could be, Robbie, that you could hear foul language.
Yeah.
No, you won't, because the VAR monitor, where it is in an isolated area. So that isn't an issue. Yeah. So you could open the microphone as a referee and have that conversation with the VAR.
When you're away from the players, over the monitor. Yeah.
Can you give me, for example, if I talk about Aubameyang's red card, I would ask him to the VAR, please show me the contact point. He shows me the contact point. Okay, I'm happy with that. Mm. Now shows it in real time because I want to see the intensity. You can't see the intensity on slow motion because everything looks 10 times worse in slow motion. Mm. So you need to watch it in real time. And then once I've made my decision, I would be saying to the VAR, my recommendation is now I'm going to change my yellow card to a red card. I'm giving a red. The VAR shouldn't be the decision maker.
Yeah.
The referee is the decision maker. He's the boss.
Yeah.
He's on the pitch. He feels it.
Yeah.
The VAR shouldn't be the referee.
Yeah.
I don't find that comfortable.
Totally agree with that.
But I want to hear the process. Mm. I want to understand. I might not agree with it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But also what it will do, Robbie, is that it'll educate people. Because if I went through the whole process of Aubameyang's, you would then be thinking, actually, I'll use that in future when I see that type of challenge.
Which you've just described about the foot and the pressure and the contact point. Everybody will hear that on a regular basis and will be more informed with the decision.
Yeah, common,
I think that's a great idea. I do like that. I think focusing on those inside the box, I think going to the monitor is, I think now we're at a point we want to see
absolutely.
That. We want the referee to own that decision, whether he made a wrong one, he has the opportunity to correct it. The offside is still going to be,
that's a tough one. There's no easy
answer. Take it out, right?
Yeah.
And then you do correct some things inside the box, with an offside is a player's at a yard offside. There, so why
someone's
going to
jump? Yeah.
It's difficult. Yeah. It might be the feet. It might be the measuring
feet. Have to go through a bit of tough times to get.
Just before we move on to the other games, I just want to ask Mike about the handball rule. The handball rule that you, not in general, the one that leads to a goal scoring opportunity. I think we'd agree that scoring a goal with your hand, that won't be allowed. But the assisting part and build up to a goal is given so many. I mean, of course, VAR can examine it.
I was refereeing in China, so we implemented it immediately. So we were given the law, and as a referee, I thought, you know what, I quite like this. Because it never felt right that a player could score a goal with his hand. Never felt right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't in the laws of the game.
Yeah.
Because it had to be a deliberate act. And I'm sorry, not one referee in the world could find out if it was deliberate. Because you ask the player, and the player's going to say no. Of course he's going to say no. So they had to take deliberate out. And what they've tried to do is they've tried to define different scenarios to get consistency with handball because it was so inconsistent.
Mm.
And they will get consistency, 100% more consistency with handball. But does it feel right?
Mm.
Because I feel for Declan Rice and West Ham.
Yeah.
We've seen others, haven't we, from Pennybox? Just flicked off somebody's
Willy
arm.
Jesus with
flicked off his hand. Yeah.
As a referee, I've got sympathy, but it's the law. So it's not the VAR's problem.
Yeah, yeah.
The VAR's checked it in accordance with the law, the way it's written. Mm. it doesn't feel right. Possibly, like you've just said, I think, does it feel better if it goes straight to the goal?
Yeah.
But then I didn't feel, if I'm being honest, it never felt right when a play again like was clean through in on goal because of a handball, an accidental handball. Yeah. It never felt, and most referees, the experienced ones would blow the whistle.
Yeah.
Why? Because it never led to anything. And if you stopped it before it led to anything, then nobody could say you've given an incorrect goal.
Yeah, yeah.
It was more controversy.
Yeah.
So referees went into a safety mode.
Yeah.
So that's why there was so many inconsistencies. So on the halfway line, it wouldn't be a handball, but the further up the pitch it did.
Yeah.
So I've tried to change it. So you are going to have more consistencies because this type of handball will always be punished. Mm. But do they need to change it for the love of football?
What do you think will allow that process to happen? That they will change it, that they will look at it? You know, the people, some of the people who are involved.
Yeah.
So, will the things like the media attention and fans shouting and things, will things like that affect them, or do they look at this coldly?
No, because people can put recommendations in. So they'll have many, many recommendations.
Yeah.
People want to change the way football's played.
Yeah.
And there'll be players. They have a group that meet ex-players to try and improve the game. Arsene Wenger's now involved in the VAR system to try and make it better. So everybody's making some recommendations.
Arsene never saw anything.
He never did. he did my bad decisions. But everybody wants to improve. But what we have at the moment is we're losing the love of football.
Yeah, absolutely.
And when football...
That spontaneity, Mark, when a goal goes in.
That emotion.
The motion, when you've seen David Moyes...
Yeah.
And I believe, when I watched it live, I thought, that's a good goal. Mm. Never dreamt Declan Rice had hit his hand.
Yeah.
And the emotion of West Ham equalising in the last minute,
celebrating
with the fans, the fans are high.
Yeah.
Now, even as a football fan, as a Newcastle fan, I'm actually can't celebrate till the ball's been kicked off.
Isn't it? Yeah.
How can that be right?
It can't be right.
It's frustrating.
You don't celebrate until the goal's kicked off. I mean, it's... Oh, you know, we can go round and round and round with it. I think some of the points you made are really good points. Yeah. And I think the handball, I just hope that changes next time around.